Put your hand on your heart. Say, I have the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. I understand the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. They come to me. They come now because my heart is soft and receptive. I am an understanding person. I understand the things of God. I have the mind of the Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. That this is my day to receive. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Well, I titled today's message, or along the lines of today's message, is about, is this sound going in and out? Alright, okay. Today's message title is, the greatest battle you will ever fight in your life is the battle between who you are now and who you want to be. The battle between who you are now and who you want to be, that's a great battle. And did you know that the world we grow up in is insane? In that there's never been a generation or a culture that's been so brainwashed by media, so much stimulation coming at us. And the whole, I did a degree in marketing. Bless you. The whole of marketing, actually marketing and advertising, is based on creating what they call a dissonance between who you are and who you want to be. So it's like, unless you have this product, it's called reference groups. Reference groups. So like David Beckham, I don't watch the news, I only watch the media now, it's trash. But basically creating an ideology, something in your mind is, this is who I should be, this is who I am, and that's who I don't want to be. And playing those three identities off each other. So the whole advertising, marketing, media, all the movies, everything is based on that, creating false images of who we want to be. So even without all that junk, and the advertising, media, marketing has only been going, what, since the 1960s, so it's still, it might seem like a long time, but actually it's still relatively new. But we've always had these problems with our identity anyway before all this stuff came about. Now, I'm not saying, thou shalt not watch TV, thou shalt not do this, thou shalt not do that. No, I'm not saying any of that, because as soon as you give a command, then people are going to go and do it anyway. But we need to have our eyes opened in the type of world we live in. And so we have this struggle between what we are and what we want to be. And if you've known Jesus for any length of time, and I guess we're here today because we're people who are serious about the things of God, we want to please God. Who wants to please God? You want to live a life that pleases God. When you're pleasing God, everything's settled on the inside of you. And okay, and you're living in that sense of peace and that sense of shalom. But you know, one thing that God does, and I love this about God, is He shatters our illusions, doesn't He? He shatters our illusions and our deceptions. And I think it really boils down to a few things. To be in a place of peace with God, so we're not in conflict with ourselves. The world, like I said, the advertising, marketing, media industry, what it's doing to children as well, is to create a conflict within people. I just caught a clip of Katy Perry. Bless. I caught a clip of Katy Perry being interviewed, and she's obviously a very confused person, and a lot of people would want to emulate her life, certainly emulate her wealth. Now, she came from a Christian home. Her parents are Pentecostal pastors, spirit-filled. They travel the United States. They've got their own church. We ministered in a church in Lakeland who are very, very good friends with Katy Perry's parents. They know Katy. They know the family. And lots of people are praying for her. But in this interview, there's this woman who's got everything, but completely broke and completely confused. And yet she's saying, and yet in it all, I feel God's hand on me. I mean, there's loads of reasons why we could all pick up a stone and throw it at her and say what a terrible person she's been. Obviously, her sin is very amplified because she's on a, you know, she's basically sucked into that entertainment industry, and her sin and her faults and failings are just amplified big time where ours are not. But the lady is in a complete confusion, and in many ways, she's got the life that many people would want to have. Okay, and so you think, well, why is she still struggling? Because here I am here, but I want to be here. So we need to learn how to eliminate conflict in our life. If we learn to eliminate this inner conflict, what actually in advertising they call dissonance. dissonance. They actually create dissonance. Okay, you know, I was going to share this today. If we can eliminate all the conflict, then we're going to start moving and become the person that God wants us to be, who's created in the image of the Son of God. Amen? And when we're in that place, we're actually in it, we're very, very happy. And you know, I remember when I first got saved in 1996, nearly 21 years ago. Yeah. And before that, my life had been a chaotic life of just foolish young man. Book of Proverbs, foolish young man. All the ex, whatever, crazy life. And here I get saved. And at the point of my salvation, I was working a job. I was doing a degree in business whilst doing a placement. And I hated this job. It was the most boring job on planet Earth you could ever imagine. Just completely mind-numbingly boring, horrible. The type of job that 6 months previous to that, I would have found excuses not to turn up, and so I'd just get sacked and get another job. But when I got saved, God made me be obedient and stick it out, even though I hated it. Do you know what? Even though my circumstances were kind of rubbish, if you like, I had such a peace in my heart because I knew I was pleasing God. I was being obedient. See, obedience in our life, where we're at now, is such a key. Look, one of the traps that people get into, listen to this, catch this. One of the biggest traps is the trap of trying to alleviate our sense of present suffering. Where we're at in our life right now may not be too great. But and God sees that, and God's not rejoicing in that, and we don't like it. We might be working a job we don't like, with our family circumstances, whatever it is. But the tendency to just want to escape that and alleviate that unpleasantness is such a path to self-destruction. We've got to find, instead of doing that, we've got to find the path of obedience to God. What is God saying? In any conflict we have, in any relationship conflict, forget the he said, she said, this said, get the strife out. What is God saying? Lord, that was so unjust, that wasn't fair. Forget that. Who cares? Where, you know, Jesus took more than that. What is God saying? And find the groove and the path of obedience in every situation, because obedience is better than sacrifice. And when we're walking in that obedience to God, the conflict goes. And with the absence of conflict, the shalom of God gets settled in our life, then our exterior circumstances begin to change. It's so important that we're in that place where we know we're in the right job. It might not be a great job, it might not be where we want to be, it's not our destiny. But we're not trying to pull levers and get free of this and free of that. We're obeying God. I'm being obedient in my finances. I'm saying no to the things I used to just splurge on 6 months ago. I'm saying no to this. I'm being obedient. I'm getting things in order. It's not very fun. It's not very exciting. And sometimes church just wants to throw us up and get us all excited and stuff like that. But I'm being obedient, and there's settled peace coming. And these other things, these are things that help us get to our destiny quicker. Knowing God has called you into the right house. Said this before, one of the things that stops people receiving from God is double-mindedness. It says in the book of James that the double-minded man or woman receives what from God? Can I hear that again? If you're double-minded, what do you receive from God?
Nothing.
Nothing. So you don't know your own head. It's like a woof. Now, one key way to get single-minded in your life is to get in the fellowship where God tells you this is your house. Because God might tell you that, and then 2 months later, 3 months later, you won't have a switch. Or we'll get wandering, we'll get itchy feet. If God says this is your house, this is where we stay, until God says clearly, in a mature way, otherwise. Because sometimes people say, well, God spoke this, and that he's not. Because when we're in fellowship, we are what the Bible calls one heart and soul. Okay? 1 Corinthians, sorry, he's a little boy, sorry, it's okay. In 1 Corinthians 1, it says this, listen, it says, speak the same thing, have the same mind. Doesn't mean we're a bunch of drones with no personality, but we are when we're in unity with the people, the double-mindedness goes. When the double-mindedness goes, the receiving from God begins to come. The frustrations go because there's that. And it's like I said the other week, look, one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. Unity is so key. We're to endeavor for the bond of the Spirit and the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Because the anointing on your life gets multiplied 1,000-fold. So you want a 1,000-fold increase in the anointing of God on your life. Amen. Do you want to try and fight the devil on your own?
No.
I mean, look, church shouldn't be a codependency thing. We all have to learn to fight. We can't just have cuddles, church. Now listen, church should be a place of love and a place of family. But if somebody is being attacked and is unstable, and we pretend that warfare is not real and we just all, you know, we just give each other nice cuddles, that's nice, but the devil doesn't cuddle people. He destroys people. And he's mean. And he's very, very focused and committed in what he does. And we can pretend it's not real. He doesn't pretend it's not real. He knows it's real. And he's committed to attacking us. And so we've got to be trained and equipped to stand on our own two feet so that we can stand against the devil, resisting and beating. Just if you've ever had a decent victory over Satan, put your hands up. Come on. I mean, obviously you've been born again, so everybody, if you're born again, you have beaten the devil, amen, in Jesus' name. But you remember a time in the life when the devil's resisting you, you've been through a season of warfare, and you've come out on top. Come on, put your hands up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I think that's worth some praise. Come on, hallelujah. Come on. Because I tell you, once you know you've had a few decent victories over the devil, got a few notches on your belt, then you are set up for life. Even if you take some beatings after that, even if it's tough, even if it's discouragement, once you've beaten him several times, once you've beaten him once decisively, and then you take a few defeats after that, and you have to have defeat, then you will nail him every single time. Listen, you can't get the devil out of your life. He's going to be a feature somewhere. He's either going to be up here on top of you or under your feet. Under your feet. Under your feet. Under your feet. We can't ever let up. Our position in rest. We're called to enter his rest, but not into passivity. Passivity. We were sharing about this at our leaders' time, about passivity. You know what passivity is? It's when basically your mind is just not one open door. Have you ever been to like a shopping centre where there's multiple open doors? Multiple entrances. It's like if you are a passive person, you're like that. Your brain, your mind is just full of doors that are just wide open. And anything can just walk in there and plant a thought. You know, anything. And so, have you ever saw this with people? Some people, you can be in a conversation with them. They can be in a conversation and you watch this other person come along and completely control that person and take their conversation anywhere they want it. Salesmen are trained that way. A salesman is trained to infiltrate your mind and get you to think what he wants you to think, and that you to take your conversation, just steer you anywhere you want. Have you ever had people knock on your door and they're trying to get you to sign up for stuff and you just feel guilty straight away? Ever had that? Charity people, I'm not saying don't give to charity, but I'm going to give to the kingdom. You feel guilty. And I won't ask for a show of hands, has anyone ever signed up for that? Where inside, in a free conscience, you don't want to. I've had to learn to say, there's a great word, begins with N. No. Just say, no. No. Best thing we can teach our children is, teach them to say, no. Teach them to have a will. No. You make a decision, no or yes. That's why Jesus said, let your yes be yes, and your no be your no. Because too many people have just got wide open brains. Okay? A long time ago in the 1920s, a man of God called Watchman Nee wrote a book called The Spiritual Man. It's an absolute mega, it's not easy reading. But he wrote chapters and chapters and chapters on passivity. And this is before the media revolution, and just basically teaching passively, open door for demons completely. Demonic control of our minds has to be broken in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You're going to get that. You're going to get a strong mind. You're going to have the mind of Christ. We're going to have the mind of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Right, let's get to the Bible. Okay, I just felt that stuff that the Holy Spirit wanted to speak into our lives. Okay. Thank you, Father. Always go, always be clear. What was the last thing that God specifically instructed you with? And obey. Sometimes I think, how can you discern if you're hearing God? Think of it like this, like a traffic light is green, amber, red. Think of a series of traffic lights. Things need to line up to discern the voice of God. If you hear a voice telling you something like you need to exchange your spouse for another, is that a green, an amber, or a red light?
Red.
It's just a red light. No. If you feel a desire to better yourself and get a better job, a business, to prosper, what light is that? It's a green light, but in terms of acting now, what light is it? It's amber. So you get your lights lining up. So I ask myself, right, okay, I think I'd like to go and live in Uganda. I'd like to live in Uganda. It's a lovely country. It's very nice. It's hot and sunny. One of the nicest African countries. Why would I like to go there? Because I could have revival every day. Because I love Africans and they respond to the gospel like nothing else. So I could come, Lord, is that your will? Now straight away I think, hold on, commitments, my family's here. Commitments, this church is here. And so these things, you line up with the factors of your life. The principles, biblical principles, number one. Right, is this in the plan of God? Well, it is in the plan of God, but I need to do some waiting on God. And then I'm in fellowship with people. Okay, God puts me in fellowship. If you hear people, there's people, oh yeah, I'm hearing God, but they're not under authority, they're not in fellowship anyway. And what they're hearing may be in the general plan of God, but their life is not in order. Okay? And so lots of things need to add up in our lives before we move and make decisions. Okay? Right, praise God. So, you know, God wants us to have a good life. Okay, the good life as He terms it. Believe it. Okay, and Jesus tells us a way, 100% proof, how we can get what we want. Sounds shocking, doesn't it? Jesus taught a way of how you can get what you want. He did. Hallelujah. I heard a man of God quote this once, and it's powerful. Norvell Hills, he said, God spoke to him and said, if you will worship me, I'll give you what you want. And well, that's not real worship, because I'm worshiping you for what I want. No, real worship is a displacement of the ego and what I want. I'm in a place with God, obviously with renewed desires, therefore what I want is new and I'll have it. And you know, God wants you to prosper and your family to be blessed and all that. But if we're seeking family wholesomeness and prosperity and purpose in our life, but underlying it is fear, that's coming from ego, that's coming from self, we'll never get it. We can pray, we're blue in the face. We've got to touch the throne of God in a place of transformation where the blood of Jesus can cleanse our hearts. Then we're in a place to get what we want. Now listen, I'm saying this. Jesus spoke about a way that you can get what you want. Exactly what you want, 100% of all of the time. And straight away we'll hear this and think, well, that sounds selfish. No, ask yourself the question, who do you want to be your provider? Do you want the devil to provide your needs? Or do you want God? Now, unless we haven't noticed, we are creatures of desire. Bless you, we're creatures of desire. Nice interjection there. We're not Buddhists. Buddhism and Eastern stuff tries to eliminate desire to reach being spaced out of your head. alright, and get demon possessed basically. But without being involved in any of that, bless you, we'll cast the demons out of you later. We are creatures of desire. God has created man in his own image. God is creative. God has desires. And people's problems, listen, catch us. Our problems is we don't know what we want. People don't know what they want. Christians don't know what they want. They're double-minded. They're confused. And when we come to a point in our life when we know before God what I want, think, how old are you now? How many years may you have left on this earth? We're praying many years left. We need to sit down with God, each one of us. I'll give you this challenge this week. We need to sit down before God and look at our life and say, God, before you, work with him, Holy Spirit. What do I want? Write it down. Write it down. And it'll be refined over time. It will change. Now, I did this little exercise, and from my heart came, number one, I want to know the Father and worship him in spirit and in truth. Not just because I'm saying the right thing, because I'm a Christian, I should have won that first. Because listen, there's times, I don't know about you, in my walk with God, there's times when, if I'm really honest, Lord, I don't really feel like being a worshipper at the moment. But I know I should want to feel that, and I'm willing to be willing to change. And I need to preach on Sunday, so I need to be in the Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. I wrote that, I want to be a worshipper in spirit and truth. I want to know the Father. And I want to, second thing, I want to walk as a mature son in the power of the Holy Spirit, going about my Father's business in Jesus' name. Right? Things you want. Things you want. Most people don't have a clue. People have wishful, little wistful desires, and they want to be relieved of the painful circumstances in their emotions, in their lives. If I can just feel a little bit better now, rather than let God deal with them and go through the discipline of real change and transformation, which is painful, but yields such a harvest of righteousness in our lives. If we think, goodness me, the next 12 months could be painful. I may have to grit my teeth, I'm going to have to face some things, but 12 months from now, I'll be miles away. But if I don't go that way and I just want a relief of any temporary circumstances in my life, I just want to feel better, then in 12 months' time, I will be in exactly the same place or even further back, and I will have wasted time. A lot of people don't know what they want. Their heart. The Bible says the heart is deceitful above all things. The Bible says in Proverbs 4:23 that we are to guard our heart, for out of it come the issues. This says in the Hebrew, come the forces. May the force be with you. The forces of your life. This is what the Hebrew says. The forces of your life come from your heart. So whatever's in the heart is going to reproduce itself. It's the heart works like the soil of the ground. Whatever you put in, it's going to reproduce itself. Okay. Praise God. Many people, as well as many people, are trapped and they're waiting for some magic key. They're waiting for the magic circumstances. They're waiting for some person to come along and rescue them. People who are trapped in some kind of misery, unhappiness, may just be doing okay in life. You're not broke, but you're doing all right. But something inside is, what I want more. I want to live for God. I want to be fulfilled in Christ. And we're waiting for that magic person to come along, because something about human beings is we all kind of feel a little bit like somebody should do it for us. Somebody should help me. The government should help me. And we've got to come to a place to realize that person does not exist. That person does not exist anyway. That person to bring you what you want does not exist. That perfect circumstances don't exist. It's just an illusion. Okay? And if we live in this illusion, we'll actually draw people to ourselves who will hurt us and abuse us. Okay? We'll draw the wrong people to us, or even good people who come to us and around us will put unreal expectations upon them and will drive them from us. And what happens is that pain and failure and frustration will multiply in our lives, and we end up isolated, poor, sick and lonely. Okay, that is not, so that's not my portion. But so many people don't, they're getting trapped in this way. Why? Because they put their confidence in the flesh. They're looking for their answers in the flesh realm. On the night before Jesus went to the cross, you can read it from John chapter 13 through to 17, he's introducing his Jewish disciples into life in the spirit. There's loads, just to compress it all down, he's saying, look, this is the old covenant where your relationship with God is worshiping, trying to relate with God who's far away. This now is the new, where the Spirit of God comes to live in you and upon you and among you as a community of people. And so you need to get out of the old and abide in the new, and you need to abide in me. I'm leaving you. We're looking at a few weeks ago. Jesus said, it's better, John 16 verse 12, 7 or 12. Jesus said, it's better that I go, because the Holy Spirit won't come to you. What's he saying? Life in the Spirit is better than having Jesus with you in the flesh. Where's Jesus going? He's going to the right hand of the Father, and we are occupying his position on the earth with the Holy Spirit on us. That's what it means to abide in Christ. So we need to give up on the realm of the flesh. We need to give up on trying to find our solutions in the realm of the flesh by trying to pull this lever, change that circumstance, look at this relationship as the issue, as the key, look at even this new job, look, even more money. I guess if I was to say and prophesy over every person here, your salary is going to double by the end of the year, who would feel pretty happy about that, eh? You would feel, if I was to say, right, you're going to have 80%. Who wants to receive that 80% pay rise in your income? Right, you receive it. Do you know, we could get that, and then we just end up buying a bigger house with more expenditure and more of this and more of that. I was reading an article about people who earn over £100,000 a year. That's top 2% of the UK, and how most of those people struggle. Most of those people are struggling because they've got a bigger house, and they've got a bigger car, and they've got the kids in the nice school, and they've got this and that. And it's just, look, I want to give a clue. Listen, everybody is in the cage. Every human being on the planet is inside the cage. Katy Perry's in the cage. Now, we can be born again and go to heaven when we die, but we can still live inside the cage now. We can come out of the cage, whether we're on 100k a year or 15k a year or minimum wage a year. The sooner we come out of the cage, the better. And then we learn to stay outside of the cage. It's called living in the kingdom. It's called abiding in Christ. That these so-called natural keys in the natural realm, they don't exist. This magical person, they don't exist. What exists is fallible people. You know what? When we come out of the cage, you can have a great marriage. When you come out of the cage, you can have great friendships. When you come out of the cage, you're not going to be this isolated, lonely person, because your source, it really is God. Life outside the cage, it's becoming the person that you long to be, is a person not in a cage. That's that person. And that person is going to attract the blessing of God. Jesus said in John 15, verse 7 to 8. Listen, this is Jesus' formula. of getting exactly what you want 100% of 100% of the time. He said, John 15, verse 7 and 8, let's bring our Bibles to church or bring our phones. He said, if you abide in me, and my words abide in me, you shall ask what you want, and it shall be done for you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you live a poor, beaten down, broken life that keeps you humble, and that you have just enough sickness to keep you humble before God, that you have just enough poverty. That's how, no, God is glorified.
Amen.
That you bear much fruit. God is glorified that your life has got success written all over it in every area. If you're not experiencing that now, just let the conflict go. I'm obviously a failure. Of course you're a failure. That's why you need Jesus. God couldn't change you. He had to put you to death and put you in Christ. Goodness me, you're worse than what you think, just if anyone's listening. You're worse than what you think, so just give up on self, give up on the natural realm, and accept this. He's saying, look, abide in me. Life in the Holy Spirit is in Christ. Let my words, that's not just, yes, it's great, listen. It's great to memorize Bible scriptures. But it's what's in them and meditating on them. Look, you could sit in a language class or get an app on your phone to learn Spanish. Okay? I don't know hardly any Spanish. I've not got a gift of languages. You could learn. You could get a phrase book and go, I don't know, you could, or French. Où est la plage? Je voudrais un chocolat. Right? A little bit of schoolboy French. Very impressive. You could try and learn like that. Or you could go and live in the country for a year. Which is the best method of learning the language? Live. Why? Because you get immersed in it. It becomes experiential. So God's word has to become, there's a key here. We have to assimilate it so it's experiential on the inside of us. It's experiential on the inside of us. I love this. Just jumping ahead to another message. Jesus said that the Holy Spirit, this is John 16 verse 14. John 16 verse 14, he said, the Holy Spirit will glorify me. He will take of what is mine and declare it to you. Say, the Holy Spirit, declares God's word to me. That word declare means this, rehearse. Rehearse. So who wants to be successful here? Who wants to live a blessed life? You and the Holy Spirit need starting to get together and shut out the distractions. You and Holy Ghost need to sit down. So you and Him, and He can start taking the things of God. He can start taking this word and making it alive to you and start rehearsing it inside your spirit. So you start seeing yourself successful because you're rehearsing it like an actor called method acting. They rehearse to the point where they get inside the character. I mean, this is a bit of a negative one. The actor Heath Ledger, he played the Joker in Batman. Jack Nicholson warned him. Said, if you play that character, you better be careful, because Jack Nicholson had played the Joker beforehand. He said to Heath Ledger, be very careful about playing that character. You'll lose your mind. Heath Ledger took his own life because he got so into that demonic character that the demons got right in him. That's something, isn't it? Now, we have a much better script than a Batman movie. Amen. We got the living Word of God. Let's chuck all the other scripts out. When the script of the world on the BBC 6 o'clock news wants to tell you this and about that, about the economy, God's script, His constitution has something else to tell you. So we get this on the inside of it, and the Spirit of God begins to rehearse it in our life. And we come to a place where we actually know what we want. We actually come to a place where I know, I'm not confused anymore, I know what I want. I know what I want. I'm sick of having no money, I want more money. No, that's not wanting. That's just wanting out of some present discomfort in life. Wanting something is a change of the will on the inside. It's a transformation from God. I don't have much now, and I'm going to have to squint and save. I'm going to have to do without in some areas. But I have seen something in the Spirit of God. I've gotten serious with God, and He's burned something on the hard drive of me. He's rehearsed it on the inside of me. And I want that. And I tell you, you will get it. You will pull yourself towards it, and you will pull it towards you. Even if your natural circumstances, nothing lines up whatsoever. I promise you, it's like the forces of nature will literally change, because God Himself will go to work in your situation. Because it's like God saying, finally. You don't just want relief out of your circumstances. You don't want just a little bit of change. You don't want to just feel better. You actually want. You've let me deal with your heart, and you will pull yourself towards that objective. Hallelujah. We're not wishful thinkers. We're going to end in a moment. So I'm not just a wishful thinker. I'm not just a wishful thinker. You see, we were looking at some leadership stuff last Monday night, and it was great. And one of the points I came across was, every person has potential. But for many people, their potential goes where? Goes in the grave. Say, that's not me. It's not me. But in some part, all of our desires and all of our potential has to go in a grave. Which one we decide. Our potential, our calling, our gifting, our destiny, all of it is going to go, listen, it's going to go in a grave. It'll either go in the grave with us at the end of our life, untapped, and a sense of frustration, or like a corn of wheat, it's going to fall into the ground and die and go into that grave with Jesus Christ. And what comes out the other side is resurrection life, is unbeatable. Unless a corn of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. So all of the natural, all of our way of grasping and trying to change this situation, that situation, waiting for this magic key, that magic person, all dies. I simply become a worshipper. One of the most important places to be a worshipper is at the tomb. When everything seems to have died and we're still worshipping, we think we're worshipping at a tomb, but I prophesy in Jesus' name, you're worshipping at a place of resurrection. Because the disciples, they just completely lost the plot. They had no faith, total unbelief. But that lady, she was worshipping what she thought was the tomb. She was worshipping at the place of resurrection. And if you can worship in that place, everything of God's calling in your life will come out indestructible. And there is not enough demons in hell that can stop that destiny. There's not enough people that could queue up in the world and slam. If a million doors got slammed shut in your face, who cares? Because I prophesy and I declare, take this, what He closes, no man can shut. But what He opens, no man, no devil can close. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So where people look, closing up, we are people like Jesus said. He said, look, it's better that I go. If I don't go, the Holy Spirit's not going to come to you. He said, I have many things to say to you, but you can't bear them now. If only I just had Jesus with me in the flesh. If only I had that magic person, Jesus Himself. Even that itself is not sufficient now. Not that we're this side of the cross, this side of the resurrection. Jesus said, no, you're better having the Spirit. I'm in heaven making intercession for you. You're better having the Holy Spirit. Life in the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, is better than having Jesus physically with you in the flesh, according to Jesus. My brain doesn't always compute that, because there's certain things, he said, I'd love to be able to show you, but you can't get it, because you're living in the realm of the flesh and of the natural, where people have the Spirit. Come on, let's finish there. It's just gone 10 to. Hallelujah. Let's praise God. I just want to be. Thank you, Jesus. You see, we have a kingdom that works.
Amen.
Listen, this is how the kingdom will work in our life. Who's excited about being part of a kingdom that works? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Being part of a kingdom that actually works. It's like, look, if you lived in some horrible country in the world where it's a failed state, then it's like bedlam, like Somalia, somewhere crazy like that. And it's dangerous, and it's poverty. And you got given a visa to the United Kingdom, you'd be pretty happy, wouldn't you? And then you arrive in this country and things work. Not perfect. We had some people coming from Burundi, and awesome miracle with a guy who was crippled with gunshot wounds on two sticks, and God made him walk. And his children, when they came across here, when they saw the police car coming, they'd run. It took them a few weeks to figure out that the police here won't come kick your door down and shoot you and things like that. Like, you know, we're living in a good country. Things work. The law of the land is rule of law. It's not perfect at all. And here we are. Come on, let's get out of the natural. Let's get out of the failed state of Satan's rubbish kingdom.
Amen.
And get in the kingdom that works.
Amen.
The kingdom of God functions. It has a government. It has a... Hallelujah. Come on, let's give him praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. The kingdom of God works. It works. The kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy. Let's stand together. We're going to do some declarations. The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, shalom, joy in the Holy Ghost. It's power, and that power is working in my life, in my finances, in my health. Hallelujah. I am free. Come on, let's see the kingdom work right now. Who's got pain in their body? Let's see the kingdom work now. Let's see Jesus the boss. Come forward though, anyway. Please come forward. See, she's sitting on, listen, get this testimony. I'm not shy to say, some people, listen, learn from it, learn from what a live testimony. Diane came 6 weeks, 7, 8 weeks ago. I'd had 15, 20 years of arthritis in your hands. Okay, and you said to me before 11 o'clock, you said it'd come back.
Yeah, when I woke up this morning, I felt so ill. I didn't want to come. It took me all my time to get out of bed, and my hands have swollen up, and it was really painful. And during the worship, the pain's gone.
It's pain's
a bit
gone.
Swollen, but there's
100% no pain.
Yeah.
Now, had I grabbed your hand, and that would have hurt.
I'd have thumped you.
You would have thumped me with a good hand. Listen, the kingdom of God, right? We get healing, and we think, oh, well, I'm healed. 3 months later, was I healed? I feel sick again. No, it's still the kingdom. We've got to learn to get the kingdom established in us. We're sharing with someone before. It's like this country, you come from Somalia where there's no rule of law. You come to the UK, people are not allowed to burgle your home. There's certain things people are not allowed to do. There's laws, but there's still criminals here who violate laws. And so the law enforcement is to enforce on the enemy. When we're kingdom people, we've got to learn to say, I enforce God's word upon the head of the devil. Not coming in my house. Not coming in my kids. On my marriage. You've got to put them under your feet. Resist them. Resist them. Resist them. Resist them. Submit to God. So I submit to God. All disorder leaves my life. I repent of all rebellion, of being out of line with the will of God in any area of my life. I submit to God. I resist the devil. That means I actively oppose him. And he flees from me.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise